even though there were other submachine guns ahead of the MP40, including the MP18 and the MP38. Really, when you think about World War II, it's the MP40.
In the aftermath of the First World War, there's this interesting dynamic about Germany and its development of automatic firearms. The Versailles Treaty limited the size of the German military, limited what types of weapons they could develop and they could equip their military with. And there are strict limits placed on military armament. The limitations that spoke to police forces were a little bit less strict. And so in the interwar period, Germany begins developing some submachine guns that they develop and then distribute among police forces in an area where they can skirt around one of the provisions of the Versailles Treaty. They develop through a number of different variations and patterns that bring us all the way up to the outbreak of World War II. Shortly before the invasion of Poland, the Germans develop what they call the MP38, the Maschinenpistol 38. The MP38 submachine gun was an interesting innovation for them because it moved away from using a wooden stock and it developed instead an underfolding stock. It made use of a 32-round detachable box magazine holding 32 9x19 millimeter cartridges. It fired from the open bolt blowback position. It used a receiver that was a machined piece of steel, and it immediately demonstrated that it was a fantastic little weapon.
By 1940, the Germans realized that they were gonna need a lot more guns. In 1940, April, a new variant of the MP38 operated just the same, was introduced, but it was called the MP40. And the chief difference between the 38 and the 40 was construction. The MP40 was designed for ease of manufacture. It had a stamped receiver. But this is a 9mm submachine gun, perhaps the most iconic submachine gun of World War II, with its magazine well out front, with its stick magazine feeding into it, with a rear pistol grip, and then of course a folding buttstock.
So what you saw in the MP40 was the forerunner of modern designs that would last 50 years after it, even today with the MP5. But the MP40, 9mm Luger, moderately powerful chambering, and an almost 9-pound gun that really, you know, did not feel like a pig at all. It held well, it aimed easily, and when you pull the trigger on that thing, full auto, you really have something that's quite controllable, quite easy to aim and keep on target. It's just a pleasure to shoot. Well, with the MP40, Irma Works had gotten to the point where they were really making what could be considered a really almost a modern gun in terms of its design and even selection of materials and use of sheet metal stampings for the receiver rather than large blocks of forged and machined steel.
By producing a submachine gun that made use of a sheet metal tube, making extensive use of not just sheet metal, but also a new form of plastic called Bakelite, they come up with a lightweight, handy, compact 9mm full auto submachine gun that's really as simple as it could be. It fired at a cyclic rate that was sufficiently low enough, between 500 and 600 rounds per minute, that you did not need to install fire control components to allow selectability from semi-auto to full auto. You just made a simple full auto trigger mechanism and a cyclic rate of fire slow enough to where you could squeeze off single rounds or easily squeeze off doubles.
The basic difficulty with the MP40 was the magazine. From a design perspective, it was the most troublesome. It was a double column but single position feed magazine, which meant that as the cartridges came up into the magazine and to be fed, two columns had to merge into one. And that caused problems, particularly in Russia, in the mud and the dust, and later in the snow and the ice, because those increased the friction. And the cartridges did not mesh well, and stoppages would ensue. And that was the principal problem with the MP40. Other than that, it was a fairly serviceable, reasonably rugged gun. It was a pioneer from a development perspective. It was a pioneer of submachine guns.
There are three main makers of the German MP40 submachine gun: Heinel, the designer of the gun, Erma, and of course Steyr. And of course, later in the war, those plants were fed by subcontractors and components from all over the area. The MP40 really became an icon of the German Army during World War II. Even though there were more effective guns introduced, in particular the Sturmgewehr, the MP40 was used by all kinds of troops. It was used by motorcycle troops, by armored troops, by officers, NCOs, and the gun was really only limited by its chambering. I mean, this is a 9mm Luger open bolt blowback operated submachine gun. So its effective range is not that of a rifle, a machine gun, or even the world's first assault rifle, the Sturmgewehr.
The MP40 has a very successful career arming the German military. It continues to arm militaries of the world in the aftermath of the Second World War. It fights on, and it fights on today in motion pictures constantly, where you see this firearm. It's one of the most abundant of them all. And for the price, the MP40, for a time, was a great collector's item for the NFA community, the National Firearms Act community that legally own fully automatic firearms. In fact, one of the most desirable things for any NFA collector is to own an actual 100% CNR, or Curio and Relic, German MP40, meaning it's a 100% German version. For a very long time, leading up to 1986, a more economical alternative to a 100% German CNR MP40 submachine gun was what we started to call the tube guns. So a parts kit got imported into the US, a manufacturer in the US, in this case a company called DLO, took sheet steel, formed it into an MP40 receiver, assembled an MP40 submachine gun on that US-made receiver, and then registered the firearm. This was prior to 1986, when you could still do that. And so for a very long time, these American-made receiver tube guns were a great economical alternative to owning a 100% German MP40 submachine gun.